Hey guys, welcome to this month's Global Men's Gathering. I'm so excited that you are committed to be right where you're at, ready to receive something from the Lord to increase your faith, increase your potential as the magnificence of who God has created you to be. Guys, this is going to be a time that you want to invite other men into. So no matter where you're watching this, I want to challenge you to open up social media, share this live stream with at least one person, maybe on your newsfeed, because I believe what God has to share with all of us today is going to challenge us all and push us to be more effective for His kingdom on this earth. I am so excited for what we're about to experience together. Man, I am so pumped that we all get to dive into God's Word together. All of us around the world. Soulcon right now, we're reaching men in 38 different countries, and we're just growing stronger. I want to thank you. This ministry is supported by men like yourself that say, you know what, I want to be a part of the solution. Statistically, men's ministry is dying across the world, but you guys are standing in support. We have so many guys on a monthly basis supporting this ministry, and we're grateful for that because, man, we are going to see, and we're seeing it now, I believe the greatest revival the world has ever seen starting in the hearts of men around the world. So thank you for joining, for gathering with men in your area. And man, if you're watching this and you're just seeing this on a social media feed, I want to encourage you. We have a Soulcon community of over 6,700 men that are all warriors, ready to encourage you, pray for you, walk in this life of faith with you, which we know is just comes with so many challenges and so many troubles, like Jesus said in John 16:33, that in this life you'll have trouble, but be of good cheer because I've overcome the world. And we serve a God that's overcome the world. Praise Him for that. But sometimes we need reminder of that. We need brothers to walk with us. So if you're watching this and you're by yourself, I want to encourage you. You need to get connected with men in your life. So man, let's dive in today. What I want to share with you is something that has really been challenging me. And I believe if you listen, it will challenge and impact the way you view everyday operation in your personal life. So I want to ask you the question, and I want you to open your heart before the Lord. If I looked at you and me and you and Jesus were physically sitting in a room together, and I'm watching and I'm seeing Jesus look across the table, and He looks to you and He says, according to your faith, let it be done to you. In that moment, what would I watch in your life? What would I see? Would I see the miraculous? What would transpire in that next moment if Jesus looked at you and said, according to your faith, let it be done to you? Would I see God's supernatural work match your faith in Him and healing, miraculous, take place? Guys, we have to get to what this is. So hopefully by the end of this this time that we have together, we'll be able to answer that to say, man, if God said that to me, like what if Jesus looked at Walt Disney? Now, I don't know where Walt Disney's faith was at, but what if He looked at Walt Disney and said, according to your faith, let it be done to you. And Disney World, which was his faith and driver and passion, what if that's what he was longing for? And we know that it is what he was longing for. So I want you to step outside of what you typically think when we're talking about this, because I believe God wants to expand all of our faith in who He is. Now, this is not a prosperity gospel message. I can't stand the message of, God, I'm going to say this and you're going to do it for me. No, no, we're going to come before God with a heart of expectation in who He is, because what we do is all for Him. What we do is all to glorify Him. But I think there's a problem that we have to face. I want to start in Matthew 9, 28 through 29. We have to see this in Scripture, and I want to address the problem, and I want to talk through the solution with each one of us, and it's going to be personal for you. Matthew 9, 28 through 29 is recorded. When He had gone indoors, the blind men came to Him, and He asked them. So Jesus asked the blind men, do you believe that I am able to do this? And He's talking about healing their sight. Yes, Lord, they replied. Then He, Jesus, touched their eyes and said, according to your faith, let it be done to you. These blind men came to Jesus, and they were ready to give an answer when Jesus responded to their actions. And Jesus looked in and He said, do you believe that I'm able to do this? What was their answer, right? Their answer was, yes, Lord. And Jesus touched their eyes and said, according to your faith, let it be done to you. Guys, we serve a God that is pleased with our faith. Hebrews 11:6 shows us that you cannot please God without coming to Him in faith. Like, it is our faith that pleases the heart of God. Now, let me clarify something that we have to get through as men. You cannot make God love you more, period. There's nothing you can do in your life to make God look at you and love you anymore. But there is something that you can do that will please God. And if you're living your life as a man that doesn't care about pleasing God, you don't understand grace. Now, we have to get to the place where we understand what grace is, because grace is a call to excellence. Grace is a call to honor and praise the King of Kings. But if we use grace and we accept it to be mediocre, what happens, we know, is it's not pleasing to God. It doesn't change His love for us. But God's heart is moved in what pleases Him by a sacrifice of praise, by a sacrifice of faith. Now, we know, we study all the time in Soulcon, that we have an enemy warring against us. And it wasn't until studying this that I started to see, oh man, this is what he's warring for. What's Satan's goal to steal? We talked through this in the build a wall message. Satan's goal is to steal your knowledge of who Jesus is and who you are in Jesus. Why does he wage such a magnificent strategic war at your soul for that? We have to uncover it. We have to get to the bottom of it, because here's what I want to tell you watching today. You have passions that will change the world around you if you have the courage to walk them out. And I promise you, you have passions from the Lord that you don't have money to back up. God doesn't, he's a God that wants us to live by faith. So if he's calling you to something and your major deterrent is money, and that's why it's stopping you, you're not walking in faith like you should. I heard somebody say, which was magnificent, God's net worth hasn't changed since the point ever, but since the point of creation, his net worth has never changed. So understanding God isn't a God that's short of money. He is a God that is short of men standing up in faith saying, I don't doubt your word. I have the courage to live by faith, to press in and see mountains moved in my life. But this is what I'm going to tell you. The passions you have in your heart, you will face discouragement. You will face the naysayers. You'll face so much opposition. But if God is for you, it doesn't matter who's against you. If God placed the passion on your heart, that it's His will for it to be done, but He's leaving it to you as a special forces soldier for King Jesus to walk out, I promise, the bill is His. He'll take care of it, but he's gonna steward your character along the way. Because success, man, God's not afraid of you having success. He made Solomon, one of the wealthiest king that's ever walked the face of the earth, one of the wisest kings in the history of the world, one of the wisest men to ever walk on this earth. God is not somebody who's hoarding His blessings from us, but He's somebody that has seen over and over again success and blessings destroy a man's soul, because we can get sidetracked and sidelined by the magnificence of God's blessing, and we stop seeking His face because we're so impressed with His hand. Guys, we have to get into this today. We have to dive, and I need you to be transparent with me. There's this the constant battle in your soul and my soul to say, do you really believe all of God's word? Do you look at God's word like a kid looks at a present on Christmas morning? Are you so excited every morning that you pray like David did in Psalm 119 and said, God, open my eyes that I might see the wondrous things in your word? Well, if you're not, I want to challenge you. You can be there. We all need to be there. We need to be people that look at God's word and say, God, your word is a lamp to my feet, and this journey is magnificent. God, I want to see your word work through me in a way to where my passions become a reality. That my passions becoming a reality means souls impacted for the message of Jesus Christ all around the world. And your passions becoming a reality. If your passions don't involve impacting with the good news of Jesus Christ in any sphere of influence that you're in, let me promise you, it's not a passion from the Lord. Every passion that you have from the Lord involves advancing His kingdom. Now, let me, man, just honest, right? I was at the Rewired conference recently where I was with my friend Andy Irwin. His passion is to see people moved through amazing movies. Now, the budget is astronomical to do these, but if you've seen I Can Only Imagine, Andy and his brother John started that dream project in their heart and talked to Bart Miller and Amy Grant and said, let's make this into a movie. And what did they do? Millions of lives were impacted. Massive success of a movie because they had the courage to step out. They didn't have the money to step out. They had to just step. And the story of faith with them is incredible. But what happened on the other side of it, by them using their gifts and talents, the world was impacted for the gospel of Jesus Christ. The kingdom was advanced by force. Let me tell you, your passions and your heart, a way to check them is, at the end of the day, does it involve advancing the kingdom by force? It might be you want to be an actor, or you want to be a CEO of an oil company. Whatever that is, it has to always be for the kingdom and to glorify Jesus, not to advance your kingdom and your bank account. So we have to stay focused in this, right? So I want to take you to a story of one of my favorite people in the Bible, Joshua. Now, let me get contextually where we're at with this, because I have to share a couple scriptures with you to really open our hearts up so we can see it. Joshua was a guy that was selected. We've talked about this before, but he was selected by Moses to be one of the 12 spies. Arguably, Joshua is one of the baddest dudes in the Israelite army. So you take the unit operators, the highest warriors, and you select 12 from that. Joshua was one of them. Joshua was then selected after this process. He came back from the scouting out the promised land, and only two people lived because the other 10 gave a negative report of what God could do. Super important that we get that. They give a negative report. They don't focus on the size of God. They focus on the size of the obstacle ahead of them. What happens? They all die. Joshua and Caleb live. Joshua and Caleb eventually are the only ones from that time that get to go into the promised land. So we see in Joshua chapter 1, Joshua's there, a freak warrior, now taking over as the leader of the Israelite army under one of the greatest, probably the greatest leader the world's ever seen in Moses. Obviously, the most miraculous signs and wonders have come through him. Now Joshua's stepping up to lead. And Joshua, just put yourself in his shoes. He has so many doubts, so many insecurities. Now, this guy has a ton going for him, right? But every human emotion that would come is starting to hit him because he was human like you and I are human. Like the Bible says, Elijah was a human like you and I are human. He was human. I want you to hear in Joshua 1:7-9 what he's instructed to do. And I want you to receive this as you're being instructed by the Lord. A lot of us say Rock Kazak Amatz in Soulcon as we're going through challenges. It's in my email signature. It comes from the heart of what this is. It's an ancient battle cry that is known that you say Rock Kazak Amatz when you get to heaven. They're going to know what you're saying because that was a war cry right before you go onto the battlefield to destroy the enemy. It comes from the passage, two different passages. This is one of them, Joshua 1:7-9. Be strong and very courageous. Be careful to obey all the law my servant Moses gave to you. Do not turn from it to the right or the left that you may be successful wherever you go. Keep this book of the law always on your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. Have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Do not be discouraged, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. I want you to see something in your heart. The way that you walk through life strong and courageous is not by lifting a ton of weight in the gym. Praise God for lifting a ton of weight in the gym. I call it my iron therapy, right? Like I love that time. It's not by running the fastest 5K possible. It's not by doing anything in your flesh. How you live a strong and courageous life, it starts from the meditation of your heart on God's word. You have to meditate on God's heart and on God's word. What does that mean in your life? That means when you do that and his law is always on your lips, what would your life look like if negativity never came out of your lips? If cynical words never came out of your lips? If gossip, man, let's be real, never came out of your mouth and were on your lips? What if it was God's word and you were somebody who walked in and believed that God is and has been since the beginning of time, everything the word says that he is? What would your life look like if you walked with that constant tenacity, with you're never wavering in what you do? Your life, let me tell you what it would look like. It would look like one, no matter what it was up against, you were successful. Now, let's break down successful. I'm not saying that you're going to drive a Bentley, which no problem with that. I totally understand. I just hope if you drive one Bentley, you donate a couple $100,000 to Soulcon. So you, whatever that looks like, right? But it's our heart before the Lord that he's impressed with. But successful living in God's kingdom doesn't mean material gain. Now, it can, for sure. Praise God. He's a God that he loves us. He's faithful to us. And there's people in those moments that they're operating in how God has called them to. But let me tell you, 100%. Successful living in God's kingdom comes with a blessing from his throne room to your soul for prosperity. And what does prosperity mean? It means shalom, peace in your soul. A peace in your soul this world can't buy. A peace in your soul that no matter what storms come against you, you're not going to have anxiety. You're not going to have depression. You're going to have confidence. Jesus is the anchor to your soul. God's going to give you a blessing to your soul no matter what your house, the size of your house is, no matter how many cars you have or how little cars you have. He's going to give you the ability to be content and joyful in this life. Even if you're like Joseph and you're imprisoned, he's still going to give you favor in that prison. When I was in Armenia and I saw where one of our brothers in Christ was put in a hole for 13 years and was kept alive by rations one time a day. No matter like if that's success, but this guy gets out of this hole and changes the whole country of Armenia to be a Christian nation. Guys, it's in that story is in Soulcon Challenge, the book Soulcon Challenge 2. Super cool. No matter what it is, God's heart for you looks successful from his eyes to your life. And if you're somebody who wants success outside of God's will, you're not somebody who's developed in your knowledge of God's grace. And let me tell you, when we develop in our knowledge of God's grace, we cannot help but say, God, not my will, but yours be done. Not my will, but yours be done. I want to live the life that you have for me, no matter the cost, no matter what my death looks like, no matter what my suffering looks like. God, I understand, and you pray this to the Lord, I understand anybody that follows Jesus will be persecuted. I get that, God, but I see how good you are, and I want my heart, the meditations of my heart, to be pleasing in your sight. Guys, there's a war right now for you to take this into your soul. Because you could even start to think about, man, what do I have later today? What do I have this weekend? Man, my job, all these different things, these worries and anxieties. I believe God wants you to hear right where you're at that God is passionately concerned with your passions being lived out. He is looking at you and he's passionately concerned to say, I see your passions. I see your dreams and I gave them to you. And only you can walk them out. Only you can make them a reality on this earth. We, guys, were made in God's image. God is a creator. He spoke and things came into existence. Let me tell you, there's times when you're facing opposition that you have to speak God's word and you have to change the atmosphere by speaking, by not giving up. And I want to teach you and walk through this together. One of my favorite quotes from Sun Tzu is victorious warriors win first and then go to war, while defeated warriors go to war first and then seek to win. Let me get that in your soul. Victorious warriors win first and then go to war, while defeated warriors go to war first and then seek to win. Guys, we've got to be people that every morning we win the victory before the day begins. What does that look like? Praying the Lord's Prayer out loud, knocking out your push-ups, on your knees, putting your body into a submissive state to press on, to power through, to say, you have your Garden of Gethsemane moment and the cross is already won, right? No matter what is before you, you're going to accomplish the mission because of the joy, because seeing God clearly. And you can only see God clear when your heart is pure. When we seek him diligently, we will find him. And we get to walk through this process as men. But there's a war for you to meditate on your lusts, guys. And the war is not just to destroy you. The war is that so you will never allow those passions to come out of your heart. And this is something that I've been struggling with and wrestling with to say and to believe. The problem is that we don't see why we're getting attacked. All we see is that devices are attacking us through temptations with pornography, alcohol, external substances, whatever it is constantly bombarding us. But there's not one enemy on the planet that would fight without an end goal. And we have to realize, and I want to tell you that what Proverbs 4:23 says, where we're instructed to, man, keep a vigilant guard over our heart, over our internal belief system, over our passion. We have to build a wall around our passion so when the attacks come in, your passion doesn't get ripped out. And I believe there's Walt Disney's listening to this right now. I believe there are world-changing Jim Elliot's listening to this right now. I believe there are you and me listening to hear. Like, I'll never forget where I was at when I was flying in the military and I said, I want to travel the world and speak the gospel to everybody so they can see how awesome following Christ is. Then I want to establish ministry around the world. And I remember guys thought I was crazy. And in the military, they don't hold back. There's no HR in the military. So they'd, you know, knock my stuff off the table that I was drawing on, whatever it looked like. But what did I do? I fought to see that passion become a reality. I fought through the tears. I fought through the hard times. And I want to tell you, and I'm speaking to myself too, you have to fight for your passions that you've been given. You have to fight. Nobody else can fight for you. Nobody else can make your dreams a reality, but Satan is warring to crush your heart and kill your body because he knows that he knows scripture better than we know scripture, guys. Psalms 37:4. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. Guys, I want to tell you, you delight yourself in the Lord, and Satan knows this scripture like we know this scripture as we look at it. Delight yourself also in the Lord, and he shall give you the desires of your heart. What does that mean? The passions you have in your heart. The King of Kings, who has no budgetary requirements on his life, he has no lack. He looks at you and he's going to establish the process and the passions that you have. And let me tell you, if God looked at me and said, according to your faith, let it be done to you right now, Soulcon would be established in 185 different countries. We would see headquarters for Soulcon all over the world. You'd see this picture of strength in family, strength in community. If Jesus said that, my faith would impact billions of lives. Your faith, let me promise you, your faith is the same. God's looking at you and say, don't waste a meditative thought, not one second. Don't waste a meditative thought on sin, because sin leads to death. And guys, we have to get to the place to where we don't meditate on things that break God's heart. And doing this and walking through this process is going to take you manning up and saying from the bottom of your heart, I commit to only meditate, God, on your law, on your word. Your word is good. I'll meditate on your word. I'm going to commit that what comes out of my mouth is your word and your ways, God. Jesus says, from the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. What do we have around the world? We have a problem. Men don't have God's word hidden in their heart. David said, how does a young man keep his way pure in Psalm 119? By hiding your word, God, in our heart. What was David talking about? The subconscious heart, the habitual side of who you are. Pressure comes into your life. Do you have a scripture to back it up? Do you have scripture memorized? Guys, we've got to get to the place to where we understand that we are in a war for our imaginations in Christ to let loose our passions that were given to us before the beginning of time. Hear me. Your passions, if you try to do it on your own, with your own ability, with getting a loan, with your own money, they will never become what God has planned them to become. Your passions are only possible when God steps in and does the miraculous. Your passions that you have, that God is looking at and saying, those are from me, they take, praise God for this, they take him walking you through that. If you can do your passion in your own strength, it's not from God. We've got to walk through this. And the war is to meditate, right? I went through SEER school in the military. 28 hours of torture. Starved for 6 days. What was their purpose? Their purpose was to get me to be able to meditate past the pain of my body, my circumstance, to see that I can change the way I feel internally by the way that I think. This is powerful for us to walk through. So Paul in house arrest in Philippians 4:8. I'm going to share a couple scriptures. Then I'm going to release you guys into your groups. I want transparent discussion. Finally, brethren, whatever things are true, whatever things are noble, whatever things are just, whatever things are pure, whatever things are lovely, whatever things are of good report, if there's any virtue and if there's anything praiseworthy, meditate on these things. You should not meditate on anything in your life that doesn't glorify Christ. And you could say, man, what does that look like? God wants to sit and watch a great movie with you. My wife and I, man, we watched a month ago, we saw Rampage. Let me tell you, that was amazing. It was a time where I'm sitting with the Lord. He wants to experience those moments with you. I'm talking, what a magnificent, whoever thought this out and walked through this process, God wants to be included in every area of your life. God doesn't want you to feel like you have to hide from him, like in the garden. And then when you hide, you start to sin because you get outside of God's presence, guys. It's not that God removes his presence from you. In the New Testament, if you're saved and you know Jesus as Lord and Savior, it's that you remove yourself from the knowledge of his presence in your life. So we have to be people that meditate on in our heart that we're constantly in the presence of the King of Kings, because you are. And Paul says in Romans 12, now the Holy Spirit is the author of the entire Bible, but Paul is writing under the influence of the Holy Spirit. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Your perfect will of God, guys, listen, is impossible to walk if you're not clothed in the Holy Spirit. You will not walk out God's perfect will if you don't know His perfect word. You've got to walk in the Spirit of truth to see the magnificence of Jesus come through your life. And you'll find what we know in Joshua 1:8, man, if you do that, you will have success. God's hand will be with you. It doesn't say you won't have hardship, but you'll have success. And I want every one of you to have success for God's kingdom. Now, in closing, as we're shifting in, let me share with you something. I became a Christian when I was 18. I didn't want to date because I didn't know how. I didn't want to date a girl until I met my wife. So I read God's word. I read through the Bible. I came to Ephesians 3:20. I saw Ephesians 3:20. I stood on it and I said, God, I make this request to you that the next woman that I date is my wife, because I don't know how to date. So I studied books. I went through the process. I got prepared. The next woman that I dated, God honored a year and a half later, was my wife. And God honored a request I made from the bottom of my heart. And I believe with our passions and our life, He looks at you and says the same thing. But listen, Ephesians 3:20 in the Message translation, which is my favorite translation, it says, God can do anything, you know, far more than you could ever imagine or guess or request in your wildest dreams. He does it not by pushing us around, but by working within us, His Spirit deeply and gently within us. Let me tell you, as you shift into this time, I want you to talk through with your group what passion is in your heart that if you died today would not impact thousands of lives. What is the thing inside of your heart that is pressing you onto the finish line to say, it's better for me to go be with Jesus, but it's better for everybody around me that I stay here? What is that passion? And I want to challenge you with your group. Are you thinking through God's word, meditating on His word with the perspective of Ephesians 3:20? That God can do anything, you know, far greater than any request that you have. Like he's so good. Is that your meditative state of your heart? And if not, what in your life do you have to shift? Because guys, I believe this message is for your heart. It's for my heart to say you have passions that I believe today the Holy Spirit wants to unlock the door and see those passions impact this world. It's going to take strength and courage and not being afraid. Guys, I love you. I hope this impacted your soul like it has mine. As we shift into groups, be transparent, be vulnerable. I can't wait until next month for the Global Men's Gathering. Invite people. Guys, we'll see you then. I love you guys. I'm a man on a mission.